300 film from Wikipedia, the free encyclopedia, at en.wikipedia.org. 300 is a 2007 film adaptation of the graphic novel of the same name by Frank Miller, and is a fictionalized retelling of the Battle of Thermopylae. The film was directed by Zack Snyder, while Miller served as executive producer and consultant. The film was shot mostly with a superimposition chroma key technique to help replicate the imagery of the original comic book. Spartan King Leonidas, Gerard Butler, and 300 Spartans fight to the last man against Persian god king Xerxes, Rodrigo Santoro, and his army of more than 1 million soldiers. As the battle rages, Spartan Queen Gorgo, Lena Headey, attempts to rally support in Sparta for her husband. The story is framed by a voiceover narrative by the Spartan soldier Delios, David Wenham. Through this narrative technique, various fantastical creatures are introduced, placing 300 within the genre of historical fantasy. 300 was released in both conventional and IMAX theaters in the United States on March 9, 2007, and on DVD, Blu-ray, and HD DVD on July 31, 2007. The film's opening was the 24th largest in box office history, although critics were divided over its look and style. Some acclaimed it as an original achievement, while others criticized it for favoring visuals over characterization and its controversial depiction of the ancient Persians. Contents: 1. Plot. 2. Cast. 3. Production. 4. Soundtrack. 5. Promotion and release. 6. Reception. 6.1. Box office. 6.2. Reviews. 6.3. Awards and nominations. 6.4. Historical accuracy. 6.5. Controversy. 7. Popular culture. 8. Sequel/prequel. Section 1. Plot. Over Delios' narration, the life of young Leonidas is depicted, chronicling his journey from a boy to a man per Spartan doctrine. Years later, after Leonidas is crowned king, Persian messengers arrive at the gates of Sparta demanding its submission to King Xerxes. Offended by their threats and behavior, King Leonidas and his guards kick the messengers into a well. Leonidas visits the ephors, proposing a strategy to repel the numerically superior Persians by using the terrain of Thermopylae, the Hot Gates. His plan involves funneling the Persians into a narrow pass between the rocks and the sea. The ephors consult the oracle, who decrees that Sparta must not go to war. As Leonidas departs, a messenger from Xerxes appears, rewarding the ephors for their covert support. Defying the ephors, Leonidas follows his plan, gathering 300 of his best soldiers. Along the way to Thermopylae, they are joined by Arcadians and various other Greeks. They construct a wall at Thermopylae to contain the approaching Persian advance. Meanwhile, Leonidas encounters Ephialtes, a hunchbacked Spartan, whose parents fled Sparta to spare him certain infanticide. Ephialtes asks to redeem his father's name by joining Leonidas, warning him of a secret path the Persians could use to outflank and surround them. Leonidas is sympathetic to the eager warrior, but rejects him, as Ephialtes cannot properly hold a shield, which would compromise the Spartans' phalanx formation. Prior to the battle, the Persians demand that the Spartans lay down their weapons. Leonidas refuses, and with their tightly knit phalanx formation, the Spartans use the narrow terrain to repeatedly rebuff the advancing Persian army. Xerxes personally approaches Leonidas to persuade him to surrender, offering Leonidas wealth and power in exchange for his loyalty. Leonidas declines, promising instead to make the God King bleed. Outraged, Xerxes sends in his elite guard, the Immortals, whom the Spartans dispatch. As the Spartans continue to defeat Xerxes' forces, Ephialtes defects to the Persian king and reveals the location of the secret path. When they realize Ephialtes' treachery, the Arcadians retreat. Leonidas orders a reluctant Delios to return to Sparta to tell the council of their sacrifice. In Sparta, Queen Gorgo reluctantly submits sexually to the influential Theron in exchange for help in persuading the Spartan Council to send reinforcements to Leonidas. When Theron betrays her in front of the Council, Gorgo kills him out of rage, which spills open a bag of Xerxes' gold from Theron's robe. Marking his treachery, the Council unites against Persia. At Thermopylae, as the Persians surround the Spartans, Xerxes' general demands their surrender, again offering Leonidas titles and prestige. Leonidas seemingly bows in submission, allowing one of his men to leap over him and kill the general. A furious Xerxes orders his troops to attack. As Persian archers shoot at the remaining Spartans, Leonidas rises and hurls a spear at Xerxes, cutting the Persian, thus making good on his promise to make the God King bleed. Visibly disturbed by this reminder of his own mortality, Xerxes watches as all of the Spartans are felled by arrows. Concluding his tale before an audience of attentive Spartans, Delios declares that the 120,000-strong Persian army that narrowly defeated 300 Spartans now faces 10,000 Spartans, commanding 30,000 Greeks. Praising Leonidas' sacrifice, Delios leads the assembled Greek army into a charge against the Persian army, igniting the Battle of Plataea. Section 2. Cast. Gerard Butler as King Leonidas, King of Sparta. Lena Headey as Queen Gorgo, Leonidas' wife. Dominic West as Theron, a corrupt Spartan politician. David Wenham as Delios, narrator and Spartan soldier. Rodrigo Santoro as King Xerxes, King of Persia. Michael Fassbender as Stelios, young and spirited Spartan soldier. Vincent Regan as Captain Artemis, Leonidas' loyal captain and friend. Andrew Tiernan as Ephialtes, deformed Spartan outcast. Andrew Pleven as Daxos, Arcadian soldier. Tom Wisdom as Astynos, Captain Artemis' eldest son. Stephen McHattie as the Loyalist, a loyal Spartan politician. Peter Mensah as Persian messenger. Kelly Craig as Oracle Girl. Tyler Neitzel as young Leonidas. Robert Maillet as Uber Immortal, giant. Section 3. Production. Producer Johnny Nunari was not the only person planning a film about the Battle of Thermopylae. Director Michael Mann already planned a film of the battle based on the book Gates of Fire. Nunari discovered Frank Miller's graphic novel 300, which impressed him enough to acquire the film rights. 300 was jointly produced by Nunari and Mark Canton, and Michael B. Gordon wrote the script. Director Zack Snyder was hired in June 2004, as he had attempted to make a film based on Miller's novel before making his debut with the remake of Dawn of the Dead. Snyder then had screenwriter Kirk Johnstad rewrite Gordon's script for production, and Frank Miller was retained as consultant and executive producer. The film is a shot-for-shot adaptation of the comic book, similar to the film adaptation of Sin City. Snyder photocopied panels from the comic book, from which he planned the preceding and succeeding shots. Quote, "It was a fun process for me, to have a frame as a goal to get to," he said. Like the comic book, the adaptation also used the character Delios as a narrator. Snyder used this narrative technique to show the audience that the surreal Frank Miller world of 300 was told from a subjective perspective. By utilizing Delios' gift of storytelling, he is able to introduce fantasy elements into the film, explaining that, quote, "Delios is a guy who knows how not to wreck a good story with truth," end quote. Snyder also added the subplot in which Queen Gorgo attempts to rally support for her husband. Image. Above, the film version of a panel from the graphic novel. Below. 2 months of pre-production were required to create hundreds of shields, spears, and swords, some of which were recycled from Troy and Alexander. An animatronic wolf and 13 animatronic horses were also created. The actors trained alongside the stuntmen, and even Snyder joined in. Upwards of 600 costumes were created for the film, as well as extensive prosthetics for various characters and the corpses of Persian soldiers. 300 entered active production on October 17, 2005 in Montreal, and was shot over the course of 60 days in chronological order with a budget of $60 million. Employing the digital backlot technique, Snyder shot at the now-defunct Ice Storm Studios in Montreal using blue screens. Butler said that while he didn't feel constrained by Snyder's direction, fidelity to the comic imposed certain limitations on his performance. Wenham said there were times when Snyder wanted to precisely capture iconic moments from the comic book, and other times when he gave actors freedom, quote, to explore within the world and the confines that had been set, end quote. Heady said of her experience with the blue screens, quote, it's very odd, and emotionally, there's nothing to connect to apart from another actor, end quote. Only one scene, in which horses travel across the countryside, was shot outdoors. The film was an intensely physical production, and Butler pulled an arm tendon and developed a foot drop. Post-production was handled by Montreal's Meteor Studios, and Hybride Technologies filled in the blue screen footage with more than 1,500 visual effects shots. Visual effects supervisor Chris Watts and production designer Jim Bissell created a process dubbed the Crush, which allowed the Meteor artists to manipulate the colors by increasing the contrast of light and dark. Certain sequences were desaturated and tinted to establish different moods. Ghislain St. Pierre, who led the team of artists, described the effect, quote, everything looks realistic, but it has a kind of a gritty, illustrative feel, end quote. Various computer programs, including Maya, RenderMan, and RealFlow, were used to create the spraying blood. The post-production lasted for a year and was handled by a total of 10 special effects companies. Image, above, a scene during filming. Below, the finished scene. Section 4, Soundtrack. Main article, 300, Soundtrack. In July 2005, composer Tyler Bates had begun work on the film, describing the score as having, quote, beautiful themes on the top and large choir, but tempered with some extreme heaviness, end quote. The composer had scored for a test scene that the director wanted to show to Warner Brothers to illustrate the path of the project. Bates said that the score had, quote, a lot of weight and intensity in the low end of the percussion, end quote, that Snyder found agreeable to the film. The score was recorded at Abbey Road Studios and features the vocals of Azam Ali. A standard edition and a special edition of the soundtrack, containing 25 tracks, was released on March 6, 2007, with a special edition containing a 16-page booklet and 3 two-sided trading cards. The score has given rise to some controversy in the film composer community, garnering criticism for its striking similarity to several other recent soundtracks, including James Horner and Gabriel Yared's work for the film Troy. The heaviest borrowings are said to be from Elliot Goldenthal's 1999 score for Titus. Remember Us from 300 is identical in parts to the finale from Titus, and Returns of a King is similar to the cue Victorious Titus. On August 3, 2007, Warner Brothers Pictures acknowledged in an official statement, quote, a number of the musical cues for the score of 300 were, without our knowledge or participation, derived from music composed by Academy Award-winning composer Elliot Goldenthal for the motion picture Titus. Warner Brothers Pictures has great respect for Elliot, our longtime collaborator, and is pleased to have amicably resolved this matter, end quote. Section 5, Promotion and Release. The official 300 website was launched by Warner Brothers in December 2005. The conceptual art and Zack Snyder's production blog were the initial attractions of the site. Later, the website added video journals describing production details, including comic-to-screen shots and the creatures of 300. In January 2007, the studio launched a MySpace page for the film. The Art Institutes created a microsite to promote the film. At Comic-Con International in July 2006, the 300 panel aired a promotional teaser of the film, which was positively received. Despite stringent security, the trailer was subsequently leaked on the internet. Warner Brothers released the official trailer for 300 on October 4, 2006, and later on it made its debut on Apple.com, where it received considerable exposure. The background music used in the trailers was Just Like You Imagined by Nine Inch Nails. A second 300 trailer, which was attached to Apocalypto, was released in theaters on December 8, 2006, and online the day before. On January 22, 2007, an exclusive trailer for the film was broadcast during primetime television. The trailers have been credited with igniting interest in the film and contributing to its box office success. In April 2006, Warner Bros. Interactive Entertainment announced its intention to make a PlayStation Portable game, 300 March to Glory, based on the film. Collision Studios worked with Warner Bros. To capture the style of the film in the video game, which was released simultaneously with the film in the United States. The National Entertainment Collectibles Association produced a series of action figures based on the film, as well as replicas of weapons and armor. Warner Bros. Promoted 300 by sponsoring the Ultimate Fighting Championship's light heavyweight champion, Chuck Liddell, who made personal appearances and participated in other promotional activities. The studio also joined with the National Hockey League to produce a 30-second TV spot promoting the film in tandem with the Stanley Cup playoffs. In August 2006, Warner Bros. Announced 300's release date as March 16, 2007, but in October, the release was moved forward to March 9, 2007. 300 was released on DVD, BD, and HD DVD on July 31, 2007 in Region 1 territories, in single disc and two disc editions. 300 was released in single disc and steelcase two disc editions on DVD, BD, and HD DVD in Region 2 territories beginning August 2007. On July 9, 2007, the American cable channel TNT bought the rights to broadcast the film from Warner Bros. TNT will be able to start airing the movie in September of 2009. Sources say that the network paid between $17 million and just under $20 million for the movie. TNT agreed to a 3-year deal instead of the more typical 5-year deal. Section 6. Reception. Section 6.1. Box Office. 300 was released in North America on March 9, 2007, in both conventional and IMAX theaters. It grossed $28,106,731 on its opening day and ended its North American opening weekend with $70,885,301, breaking the record held by Ice Age: The Meltdown for the biggest opening weekend in the month of March. 300's opening weekend gross is the 24th highest in box office history, coming slightly below The Lost World: Jurassic Park, but higher than Transformers. It was the third biggest opening for an R-rated film ever, behind The Matrix Reloaded, $91.8 million, and The Passion of the Christ, $83.8 million. The film also set a record for IMAX cinemas with a $3.6 million opening weekend. 300 opened 2 days earlier on March 7, 2007, in Sparta and across Greece on March 8. Studio executives were surprised by the showing, which was twice what they had expected. They credit the movie's stylized violence, the strong female role of Queen Gorgo, which attracted a large number of women to the movie, and the MySpace advertising blitz. Producer Mark Cannon said, quote, "MySpace had an enormous impact, but it has transcended the limitations of the internet or the graphic novel. Once you make a great movie, word can spread very quickly," end quote. Section 6.2. Reviews. Since its world premiere at the Berlin International Film Festival on February 14, 2007, in front of 1,700 audience members, 300 has received generally mixed reviews. While it received a standing ovation at the public premiere, it was reportedly panned at a press screening hours earlier, where many attendees left during the showing and those who remained booed at the end. Critical reviews of 300 are divided. Rotten Tomatoes reports that 60% of North American and selected international critics gave the film a positive review, based upon a sample of 214, with an average score of 6.1 out of 10. Reviews from selected notable critics were 47% positive, giving the film an average score of 5.7 out of 10, based on a sample of 38. At Metacritic, which assigns a normalized rating out of 100 to reviews from mainstream critics, the film has received an average score of 51, based on 35 reviews. The major industry trade newspaper Variety's Todd McCarthy describes the film as visually arresting, although bombastic, while Kurt Honeycutt, writing in The Hollywood Reporter, praises the, quote, beauty of its topography, colors, and forms, end quote. Writing in the Chicago Sun-Times, Richard Roper claims 300 as, quote, the Citizen Kane of cinematic graphic novels, end quote. 300 was also warmly received by websites focusing on comics and video games. Comic Book Resources' Mark Cronin found the film compelling, leaving him, quote, with a feeling of power from having been witness to something grand, end quote. IGN's Todd Gilchrist acclaimed Zack Snyder as a cinematic visionary and, quote, a possible redeemer of modern movie making, end quote. A number of critical reviews appeared in major American newspapers. A.O. Scott of the New York Times describes 300 as, quote, about as violent as Apocalypto and twice as stupid, end quote, while criticizing its color scheme and suggesting that its plot includes racist undertones. Kenneth Turin writes in the Los Angeles Times that, quote, unless you love violence as much as a Spartan, Quentin Tarantino, or video game-playing teenage boy, you will not be endlessly fascinated, end quote. Roger Ebert, in his review, gave the film a 2-star rating, writing, quote, 300 has one-dimensional caricatures who talk like professional wrestlers plugging their next feud, end quote. Some Greek newspapers have been particularly critical, such as film critic Robbie Exiel, saying that moviegoers would be dazzled by the digital action, but irritated by the, quote, pompous interpretations and one-dimensional characters, end quote. Section 6.3, Awards and Nominations. At the MTV Movie Awards 2007, 300 was nominated for Best Movie, Best Performance for Gerard Butler, Best Breakthrough Performance for Lena Headey, Best Villain for Rodrigo Santoro, and Best Fight for Leonidas battling the Uber-Immortal. It eventually won the award for Best Fight. 300 won both the Best Dramatic Film and Best Action Film honors in the 2006-2007 Golden Icon Awards presented by Travolta Family Entertainment. In December 2007, 300 won IGN's Movie of the Year 2007, along with Best Comic Book Adaptation and King Leonidas as Favorite Character. At the 2008 Saturn Awards, the movie won the award for Best Action Adventure Thriller Film. Image. The combat scenes were heavily stylized, using slow-motion camera work. Section 6.4. Historical Accuracy. 300's director Zack Snyder stated in an MTV interview that, quote, the events are 90% accurate. It's just in the visualization that it's crazy. I've shown this movie to world-class historians who have said it's amazing. They can't believe it's as accurate as it is, end quote. He continues that the film is, quote, an opera, not a documentary. That's what I say when people say it's historically inaccurate, end quote. He was also quoted in a BBC News story as saying that the film is, at its core, quote, a fantasy film, end quote. He also describes the film's narrator, Delios, as, quote, a guy who knows how not to wreck a good story with truth, end quote. Paul Cartledge, professor of Greek history at Cambridge University, advised the filmmakers on the pronunciation of Greek names and states that they made good use of his published work on Sparta. He praises the film for its portrayal of the Spartans' heroic code and of, quote, the key role played by women in backing up, indeed reinforcing the male martial code of heroic honor, end quote, while expressing reservations about its, quote, West goodies versus East baddies polarization, end quote. Cartledge writes that he enjoyed the film, although he found Leonidas' description of the Athenians as boy lovers ironic, since the Spartans themselves incorporated institutional pederasty into their educational system. Ephraim Lytle, assistant professor of Hellenistic history at the University of Toronto, states that 300 selectively idealizes Spartan society in a problematic and disturbing fashion, as well as portraying the hundred nations of the Persians as monsters and non-Spartan Greeks as weak. He suggests that the film's moral universe would have seemed, quote, as bizarre to ancient Greeks as it does to modern historians, end quote. Victor Davis Hanson, former professor of classical history at California State University Fresno, who wrote the foreword to a 2007 reissue of the graphic novel, states that the film demonstrates a specific affinity with the original material of Herodotus, in that it captures the martial ethos of ancient Sparta and represents Thermopylae as a clash of civilizations. He remarks that Simonides, Aeschylus, and Herodotus viewed Thermopylae as a battle against, quote, Eastern centralism and collective serfdom, end quote, which opposed, quote, the idea of the free citizen of an autonomous polis, end quote. He further states that the film portrays the battle in a surreal manner, and that the intent was to, quote, entertain and shock first, and instruct second, end quote. Turaj Daryai, associate professor of ancient history at California State University Fullerton, criticizes the movie's use of classical sources, writing, quote, some passages from the classical authors Aeschylus, Diodorus, Herodotus, and Plutarch are spilt over the movie to give it an authentic flavor. Aeschylus becomes a major source when the battle with the monstrous human herd of the Persians is narrated in the film. Diodorus' statement about Greek valor to preserve their liberty is inserted in the film, but his mention of Persian valor is omitted. Herodotus' fanciful numbers are used to populate the Persian army, and Plutarch's discussion of Greek women, specifically Spartan women, is inserted wrongly in the dialogue between the misogynist Persian ambassador and the Spartan king. Classical sources are certainly used, but exactly in all the wrong places, or quite naively. End quote. Section 6.5. Controversy. Before the release of 300, Warner Brothers expressed concerns about the political aspects of the film's theme. Snyder relates that there was, quote, a huge sensitivity about East versus West with the studio, end quote. Media speculation about a possible parallel between the Greco-Persian conflict and current events began in an interview with Snyder that was conducted before the Berlin Film Festival. The interviewer remarked that, quote, everyone is sure to be translating this film into contemporary politics, end quote. Snyder replied that, while he was aware that people would read the film through the lens of contemporary events, no parallels between the film and the contemporary world were intended. Outside the current political parallels, some critics have raised more general questions about the film's ideological orientation. The New York Post's Kyle Smith writes that the film would have pleased Adolf's boys, and Slate's Dana Stevens compares the film to The Eternal Jew, quote, as a textbook example of how race-baiting fantasy and nationalistic myth can serve as an incitement to total war, end quote. Roger Moore, a critic for the Orlando Sentinel, relates 300 to Susan Sontag's definition of fascist art. However, Newsday critic Gene Seymour stated that such reactions are misguided, writing that, quote, the movie's just too darn silly to withstand any ideological theorizing, end quote. Snyder himself dismissed ideological readings, suggesting that reviewers who critique, quote, a graphic novel movie about a bunch of guys stomping the snot out of each other, end quote, using words like neocon, homophobic, homoerotic, or racist, are missing the point. Since its opening, 300 also attracted controversy over its portrayal of Persians. Various critics, historians, journalists, and officials of the Iranian government, including President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, denounced the film. As in the graphic novel, the Persians were depicted as a monstrous, barbaric, and demonic horde, and King Xerxes was portrayed as androgynous. Critics suggested that this was meant to stand in stark contrast to the masculinity of the Spartan army. Stephen Ray argued that the film's Persians were a vehicle for an anachronistic cross-section of Western stereotypes of Asian and African cultures. Image. Some criticize the portrayal of King Xerxes as androgynous. The film's portrayal of ancient Persians caused a particularly strong reaction in Iran. Azadeh Moveni of Time reported that Tehran was outraged following the film's release. Moveni identified two factors which may have contributed to the intense reaction: its release on the eve of Nowruz, the Persian New Year, and the common Iranian view of the Achaemenid Empire as, quote, a particularly noble page in their history, end quote. Various Iranian officials condemned the film. The Iranian Academy of the Arts submitted a formal complaint against the movie to UNESCO, labeling it an attack on the historical identity of Iran. The Iranian mission to the UN protested the film in a press release, and Iranian embassies protested its screening in France, Thailand, Turkey, and Uzbekistan. Image: a 300 movie poster depicting the Persian Uber Immortal. Slovenian philosopher and author Slavoj Žižek defended the movie from those who attacked it as an example of, quote, the worst kind of patriotic militarism, with clear allusions to recent tensions with Iran and Iraq, end quote. He wrote that the story represents, quote, a poor, small country, Greece, invaded by the army of a much larger state, Persia, end quote, suggesting that the identification of the Spartans with a modern superpower is flawed. Instead of seeing a fundamentalist aspect in the Spartan identity, he stated that, quote, all modern totalitarian radicals, from Rousseau to the Jacobins, imagine the Republican France as a new Sparta, end quote. In response to the criticisms, a Warner Brothers spokesman stated that the film 300, quote, is a work of fiction inspired by the Frank Miller graphic novel and loosely based on a historical event. The studio developed this film purely as a fictional work with the sole purpose of entertaining audiences. It is not meant to disparage an ethnicity or culture, or make any sort of political statement, end quote. Section 7. Popular Culture. 300 has been spoofed in various media, spawning the "This is Sparta" internet meme, with parodies also appearing in film and television. These include the short United 300, which won the Movie Spoof Award at the 2007 MTV Movie Awards. Skits based on the film have appeared on Saturday Night Live and Robot Chicken, the latter of which mimic the visual style of 300 in a parody set during the American Revolutionary War, titled 1776. 20th Century Fox released Meet the Spartans, a spoof of 300. Universal Pictures is planning a similar parody, titled National Lampoon's 301, The Legend of Awesomest Maximus Wallace Leonidas. 300 was also parodied in an episode of South Park named D-Yikes. Section 8, Sequel/Prequel. In June 2008, producers Mark Canton, Johnny Nunari, and Bernie Goldman revealed that work had begun on a sequel/prequel to 300. Legendary Pictures has announced that Frank Miller is writing the follow-up graphic novel, and Zack Snyder has declared his interest in directing the adaptation, though he is waiting to see the graphic novel before officially signing on to the project. Infobox summary of 300, with an image of the original theatrical release poster. Directed by Zack Snyder. Produced by Frank Miller, Zack Snyder, Johnny Nunari, Jeffrey Silver, and Mark Canton. Screenplay written by Zack Snyder, Kirk Johnstad, and Michael Gordon. Comic book written by Frank Miller and Lynn Varley. Starring Gerald Butler, Lena Headey, Dominic West, David Wenham, and Rodrigo Santoro. Music by Tyler Bates. Cinematography by Larry Fong. Editing by William Hoy. Studios: Legendary Pictures, Virtual Studios, Atmosphere Entertainment, and Hollywood Gang. Distributed by Warner Brothers. Release date: March 9, 2007. Running time: 117 minutes. Country: United States. Language: English. Budget: $65 million. Gross revenue: $456.1 million. You have reached the end of this spoken article. This sound file and all text in the article are licensed under the GNU Free Documentation License, available at www.gnu.org/copyleft/fdl.html. This spoken article is based on a written version dated February 13, 2009, and was recorded by Wikipedia user Tony Lay, who hopes you have enjoyed this audio presentation.